The Eighth Symphony is perhaps the least understood of all Beethoven's symphonies. It has neither the heroic grandeur of the Eroica, nor the intensity of the Fifth, nor the programmatic associations of the Pastoral, nor the visceral impact of the Seventh. Nevertheless, upon hearing that the Eighth Symphony was not as well received as the Seventh, Beethoven reportedly said, "That's because it's so much better." This retort is quite revealing. Many critics have remarked that even though the Eighth partakes of the same festive impulse as the Seventh, it tends to privilege subtlety and wit over the kind of carnivalesque abandon of the Seventh. In other words, this symphony seeks to engage us on a more intellectual level. In many ways, the Eighth seems to be an artful parody of grand symphonic ideals. It's almost like Beethoven is taking a break from lofty symphonic goals and giving himself as well as his listener the permission to explore other possibilities and take things less seriously, which is not at all to say that this symphony is lightweight or inconsequential. After all, humor too can give us valuable insights into the human condition. The main theme is quite compact. The antecedent phrase is stated in full orchestra, and it's answered by the consequent phrase in the winds and horns. Then the strings amplify the consequent phrase, and the rest of the orchestra joins in to deliver a solid, perfect, authentic cadence in the home key and launch into the transition. So far, this is all very conventional. The first hint of irregularity occurs towards the end of the transition, where the effortless flow of music up to this point is disrupted as we become curiously stuck on a B-flat dominant 7th chord in 2nd inversion. This harmony seems to come out of nowhere. It's as if a heretofore fluent orator suddenly lost his train of thoughts and began to wander into uncharted territories. The B-flat dominant 7th chord slides down a semitone to the dominant 7th of D major in 2nd inversion, so in retrospect, the B-flat dominant 7th could perhaps be understood as a German 6th in an atypical inversion. In any case, we get our first glimpse of C-sharp, which Wilhelm von Lenz, an early Beethoven biographer, describes as the note of terror. It is a disruptive element that will have profound implications in the finale. In a musical jest worthy of Haydn, the subordinate theme starts out in the wrong key of D major, before apologetically slipping down to C major, the dominant, as convention dictates. Having successfully found its way to C major, the music must now confirm the key. This proves to be a somewhat arduous task. The subordinate theme goes through a series of suspenseful, diminished seventh harmonies as it seeks to find its way to an authentic cadence in C major. As you've heard, we finally cadence in C major in measure 70, and the occasion is celebrated with prominent hemiolas. So far, we can clearly see that the exposition has presented diverse thematic segments of contrasting rhythmic characters. This is quite different from the rhythmic uniformity that we saw in the 7th symphony. Near the end of the exposition, we get this wonderful rhythmic dissonance where an arpeggiated pattern of 4 eighth notes in length wreaks havoc with the triple meter. The exposition ends with a figure of ticking octaves. The figure of ticking octaves continues into the development section, where it's combined with the head motif from the main theme. And Beethoven evidently likes the rhythmic dissonance of the arpeggiated pattern of 4 eighth notes against the triple meter so much that he uses it again. So far, everything seems quite witty and good-humored. But by measure 144, things quickly turn serious and even vehement, as we find ourselves swept away by a quintessentially Beethovenian build-up through 46 measures of intense obsession with the head motif from the main theme. Up to this point, we may have believed that this symphony would be charming and rather harmless. But this passage certainly dispels that notion, as it reveals a darker undercurrent beneath the facade of Haydnesque wit and charm. There is some ambiguity about where the recapitulation truly begins. Even though the melody of the main theme makes a glorious return in measure 190, marked triple forte, it's presented in the bass and we don't get a root position tonic harmony that we would expect at the start of the recapitulation. Note that the timpani part is actually pounding out C rather than F for 7 measures. Even when the melody is subsequently presented in the treble, the bass F is not given on the downbeat to coincide with it. So we don't really get a clear formal demarcation, rather we feel that this music is continuously evolving. Another interesting feature to note is that the consequent phrase in measure 206 takes on the guise of intricate counterpoint. Recall that we initially heard it like this. But now the melody is in the bass, and there's a counter melody that serves as a clever link to the transition that follows. So again, the music is continuously evolving. The coda takes us to D-flat major through a common tone modulation. The D-flat here is an enharmonic reinterpretation of C-sharp, the note of terror that first appeared in measure 35. It's yet another hint of what is to come in the finale. The coda parallels the development section. It similarly starts out with a combination of the ticking octaves and materials from the main theme. And the coda then similarly builds to a strong statement of the main theme. However, there are important differences between this statement and the one back in measure 190. You recall that the melody was in the bass, and there was no root position tonic harmony. Now we get the melody in the treble as well as a strong tonic pedal, so there's a sense that what has been left partially unresolved can now find complete closure. Details like this are easily missed if we're not listening attentively, but there's no doubt that Beethoven thought about them carefully, and so we begin to understand why he said that the 8th symphony is so much better than the 7th. The first movement appears to be heading towards a strong conclusion. However, Beethoven surprises us by allowing the energy to dissipate. Groups of three chords are reduced to groups of two chords, and then finally to single sustained chords. The movement ends pianissimo, and the head motive of the main theme, which opened the movement, now appears one last time to close the movement. There is something delightfully paradoxical about using the opening gesture as the closing gesture. It reminds me of a riddle. The 8th symphony has no true slow movement. The second movement is marked allegretto scherzando. It can be analyzed as a sonata form without a development section. Though only 81 measures long, this music is full of surprises. It is truly playful and mischievous to the core. The winds and horns start off with repeated staccato chords. As the tonic B-flat is not given in the bass immediately, this opening has a light floating character. This opening probably reminds many listeners of the andante movement from Haydn's Clock Symphony. Although we don't get the same tick-tock alternation here, Beethoven certainly seems to be evoking some sort of mechanical motion. But whatever mechanical device this is, we'll soon come to realize that it must be malfunctioning, because the ticking is far from being predictably regular. The phrase length is also irregular. Rather than being 4 measures long, the phrase is actually 3.5 measures long. It's first presented in B-flat major, then down a third to G minor, so we would expect to hear it next in E-flat major to continue the pattern of descending thirds. And that seems to be happening, but midway through the phrase, there's a sudden fortissimo outburst that gives an extreme contrast to the pianissimo dynamic level thus far. We're so surprised by this that we may not even notice that the phrase length has been compressed to less than 3 measures. In the subordinate theme, the prominent figure from the main theme maintains a comical presence in the bass. Meanwhile, you could say that the melody is based on the inversion of this figure. The furious gesture in measure 23 seems ridiculously excessive. Then the winds and strings engage in a kind of pointillistic Klangfarben melody. In the retransition, Beethoven employs a repeated pattern that completely disregards the bar lines, much like he did in the closing theme of the first movement. The return of the main theme becomes substantially different from its initial presentation. Rather than having the phrase restated down a third, we remain in the tonic B-flat major, and like a prima donna giving free rein to her improvisatory imagination, the melody becomes richly embellished. Curiously, the coda initially appears to be taking us to E-flat major, overshooting the tonic by an extra falling fifth. Then, at the last possible moment, there's a change of plan, and the music concludes with manic conviction on repeated B-flats. I think it would be safe to say that this is the only true minuet that Beethoven wrote in all of his symphonies. Yes, the third movement of the first symphony was actually called a minuet, but we already saw that it was really a scherzo in all but name. In contrast, this movement is deliberately retrospective. It is both a caricature and an homage to the minuet. After all, how could anyone in the early 19th century ever hope to recover the grace and simplicity of this old-fashioned dance? Perhaps one could only look back with some ironic detachment, tinged with a sense of loss. The prominent gesture in this minuet is an ascending leap where the first note is detached and the second note is sustained and often emphasized. The gesture could be heard as stately and elegant. However, because it occurs so frequently throughout the minuet, we begin to get the impression that it's a bit too full of itself, more pompous than noble. Interestingly, the trio is also in the tonic rather than a contrasting key. Its texture is more chamber-like and intimate, starting out with gentle Haydnesque lyricism. Then, in the second half of the trio, the melody suddenly turns to the minor mode, before blossoming into A-flat major, in a moment both poignant and far too brief. We won't ever get to hear this passage again because the second half of the trio is not repeated. But at least for just a little while, we can catch a glimpse of the heartfelt sincerity behind this retrospective glance at the minuet. The finale of the Eighth Symphony baffled early listeners. A reviewer for the Leipzig Allgemeine Musikalische Zeitung called it Musica Stravagante. The Italian term stravaganza translates as extravagance or eccentricity. The term has been in use since the end of the 16th century to refer to music that seeks to produce novel, extraordinary effects. Structurally, the finale is innovative. it seems to combine sonata form and rondo form. But the eccentricity of the movement chiefly stems from its harmonic daring, especially through the use of sudden half-step motions. In some ways, I see the main theme as being a more enthusiastic cousin to the main theme of the second movement. You still get a three-note figure that's stated three times, and the ticking rhythm is present as well. However, the ticking becomes so fast in the finale that you hear it more as energetic palpitations. Like in the second movement, the pianissimo opening will be disrupted by a sudden fortissimo outburst. The outburst on C sharp, a half step up from C, seems to come out of nowhere. But as we saw, there were already a few hints of this note of terror back in the first movement. Curiously though, this root interjection is completely ignored. The main theme is restated in full orchestra as if nothing strange happened. In this way, the C sharp is analogous to a clown who tries really hard, but nobody cares. And we all know, of course, that when the clown is mistreated, there tends to be dramatic consequences eventually. The transition prepares for the arrival of the subordinate theme in C major, the dominant, very convincingly. But then, just like in the first movement, the subordinate theme starts off in a wrong key, A flat major, which is a half step up from the preceding G7 harmony. The theme eventually corrects course to C major in measure 60. But rather than cadencing in C major, a G7 harmony is followed by C7, which leads back to the tonic F major and the start of the first development section. After stating the main theme in the tonic, the first development section becomes completely preoccupied with sequential treatment of the motif of a dotted rhythm followed by a two-note slur from the main theme. The section culminates in a strong statement of the main theme in A major, with an E pedal ticking in the bass. The melody finishes, but the E keeps ticking and then rises by a half step up to F, sounding impish in the bassoons and timpani, and we suddenly find ourselves back in F major once again. What's implied here, of course, is a common tone modulation. The main theme is then recapitulated in the tonic. The C-sharp interrupts brusquely as before, and again this inexplicable outburst remains unaddressed. Like in the exposition, the subordinate theme is first presented in a wrong key, D-flat major this time, before correcting course to the tonic F major. Now at this point, the music could conceivably head towards its conclusion. After all, we've had an exposition, development, and recapitulation. We're back in the home key. There seems to be nothing else left to do. Surprisingly, however, rather than confirming the tonic, the music overshoots it by an extra falling fifth and lands in B-flat major. Thus begins the second development section. The main theme is stated in B-flat major. But this is clearly terra incognita, and even the music seems to be unsure of itself. You've heard the sudden forte exclamations followed by uncertain pauses. Then the palpitation of repeated notes becomes the subject for development, heard against a sustained line. But this development seems to be much ado about nothing, a parody of heroic struggle whereby banal materials are given serious treatment. In a parallel with the first development section, the second development section concludes with a strong statement of the main theme, but in D major this time. Again, the melody finishes, leaving only the ticking motion. This time, A drops a third down to F. But what's implied, again, is a common tone modulation that brings us back to the tonic. Now we come to the second recapitulation, where the C-sharp interrupts the main theme as before, except it's now spelled as D-flat. And here things start to get really interesting. Rather than continuing on in F major as if nothing happened, the D-flat instigates palpitations hinting at D-flat major. Then the outburst is spelled as C-sharp, and the palpitations hint at C-sharp minor. No longer able to contain itself, the C-sharp announces itself three times, and it wrenches the main theme into F-sharp minor. This is an extraordinary moment. We've never heard the entire main theme in the minor mode before. Moreover, F-sharp minor is a half step up from the tonic F major, a common tone modulation from the tonic to the minor Neapolitan, which sounds like this. It's the sort of modulation that can send shivers down your spine. The German musicologist Walter Ritzler insightfully describes this passage as a sudden and surprising contrast which seems to tear open a gaping chasm beneath the hearer's feet, but which illumines the whole movement, the whole symphony. The coda is notable for being comically extravagant. We can imagine that it would be entirely appropriate as the triumphant conclusion of a piece that conveys some titanic struggle. As such, it feels out of place in this mercurial finale. But then again, its very eccentricity is totally in keeping with the spirit of the movement and the symphony as a whole. Thanks for watching.